बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर इकबाल चौधरी, कोऑर्डिनेटर जनरल ऑफ कॉम्सटेक, हिज एक्सेलेंसी एम्बेसडर असकर मुसिनॉफ, असिस्टेंट सेक्रेटरी जनरल ऑफ द ओआईसी, हिज एक्सेलेंसी मिस्टर अकान रहमतुल्लाह, एम्बेसडर रहमतुल्लीन, एम्बेसडर ऑफ कजाकिस्तान टू पाकिस्तान, हिज एक्सेलेंसी मिस्टर बेरिक अरेन, Ambassador of the Republic of Kazakhstan to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Dr. Darakhan Kedir Ali, President of the International Turkic Academy, Excellencies, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. It is always a pleasure to speak to an international gathering of people who devote themselves to science, improvement of the lot of the Muslim world, as well as those who indulge in philosophy today. And it is indeed a pleasure that we are recognizing one of the great Muslim philosophers, Abu Nasr Muhammad al-Farabi. And this is the auspicious occasion of his 1150th anniversary, birth anniversary. I personally believe that when man starts thinking about his surroundings, depending on what he knows, a burden of knowledge which is carried forward from previous generations to his mind, then he looks at his own senses and looks at the world around. There are questions which emanate, and that is why even after Socrates or Plato, the earliest of philosophers we know in Greek, after Greek mythology, the questions about our existence and questions about the earth and about the universe remain the same. Despite the fact that we know a lot, we are sometimes very confident, but as time passes, as we know more and more, we realize that we know far less than what we can imagine to be the knowledge around in the world. So philosophy has been a mixture of scientific changes, scientific improvements, the knowledge of the senses, like I said, what is happening all around, and then logic, which mixes these things. So one of the most noble sciences which is considered very pure is mathematics. Mathematics combined to logic and the information of physics, I think that has been dabbled with by philosophers all along. Philosophers in the earlier era were those who understood all sciences available. Today it's impossible. All of you sitting here are probably focusing on different era, different epochs, on small part of the big science, whether it's physics, whether it's maths, whether it's medicine. All of us focus probably on a very small part of what the world knows today. But in those eras, the philosopher was a mathematician, was a person who would talk about logic, was a person who would talk about astronomy, a person who would talk about the universe, and a person who would write about whatever is happening down in the earth. So my first exposure to philosophy was through the dialogues of Plato. When I was 16 or around that age, my mother asked me to read dialogues of Plato, and I remember reading the Republic, and I remember reading the Apology and some Sophists, etc. It was a very interesting thing to know, because nobody had exposed me to that kind of, I knew 2 + 2 = 4, and 4 + 4 = 8, but at the same time, in our daily discussions, the anchor of logic was my first exposure with Plato and his writings. But then on, I kept on reading philosophers, and my search and your search, ladies and gentlemen, all the time was to be able to find the truth. My search was to be able to find whether God exists. And whatever knowledge and arguments I could lay my hands on, I read a lot of philosophy, including Bertrand Russell in the end. And even today, there is a lot of reading which is available. And in that, compared to the fact that Plato wrote in around 450 or 350 BC, it was the Muslim era which brought all that knowledge and brought all that Greek philosophy, Aristotle, Socrates, Plato, brought it to the modern world. And that knowledge is still very important. Al-Farabi was one of the most prominent of those people who brought the knowledge of Aristotle, bil-khusus, definitely, and of others. And he wrote, and Al-Farabi was probably belonged to Central Asia, but there's no very definite thinking about it. Al-Farabi means an area which is prosperous in agriculture, related to springs, and probably near Sir Darya or Amu. He lived around that, or he came from that region. But then he translated a lot of Greek philosophy. And he too was a philosopher, a jurist, and he was called also the Muallim Sani, the second after Aristotle. Aristotle laid down that the earth was flat, and it took Galileo and the fact that the earth was the center of the universe, and it took Galileo and other scientists of the past few centuries, which then said the earth is not flat, the earth is round, and the earth is not the center of the universe. So he's Muallim Sani also, and he wrote on political philosophy. And I'll point out to a very interesting aspect of his life and of his writings. He wrote on metaphysics, he wrote on physics, he wrote on cosmology, and a mathematician, and he also wrote on music. And the relation of music to the human soul, and the fact that we saw the era of Sufism, which also relates to the same philosophy and thinking. So his predecessors were, of course, Ar-Razi, but he was acknowledged by Abu Sina and Ibn Rushd, and he Maimonides, who was a Jewish philosopher, he also praised what Farabi had written. His propositions on logic, for example, was future contingent propositions, which were initially argued by Aristotle. The interesting thing of Plato's dialogues were like today's talk shows. There were characters, and the characters were arguing with each other. And there were discussions happening on the belief of each character. And that is why all Plato's writing had characters. In fact, except for the Apology, Apology was the defense of Socrates when he was charged with different crimes, and that was his defense. So that Apology did not have any character, but all of other Plato's dialogues had characters asking and arguing on different pretexts. So one example which appealed to me, I don't exactly remember, was a mathematical example of Achilles' race with the tortoise. That was Plato in his dialogues, arguing the fact, not realizing or not putting in, or there was no reality or dimension of time. So there were three realities, three dimensions, length, width, and height, and there was no dimension. And that the argument was about that the Achilles, who was a Greek runner, who will never win the battle with the tortoise, because if the tortoise is giving a 10-foot advantage in the race, the time Achilles would reach this 10 feet, the tortoise would have gone one upon 10th of the foot further ahead. And when Achilles would reach that 1/10 of a foot, the tortoise would have gone 1/100 of a foot ahead. So it was a mathematical argument. Unless you bring in the dimension of time, it wouldn't get settled. So Aristotle had a future contingent proposition in which a sea battle, for example, a statement like the sea battle will happen tomorrow, that statement will always be true, because tomorrow, when tomorrow comes, the sea battle will have happen tomorrow. And when day after tomorrow comes, the sea battle would have tomorrow. And Aristotle argued with that kind of argument, and Al-Farabi also gave some further thought on that. But the most impressive part was that the breadth of people's thinking, breadth of Al-Farabi's thinking, when he wrote on the on music and the fact that music has an effect on the soul, was impressive by itself. And I still remember my father, according to the Islamic teachings, never liked music. And when we started practicing together, I believe I put up background music in my clinic, and he disliked it. But when he got ill and he went to the United States, when he got ill, he had to be in the hospital. And when he came back and he said, beta, music was very soothing. So something, when you take upon judgments, you can always learn what happens in the future. Al-Farabi wrote his book of letters, which was a semantic discussion. And semantics is a very important part of all our thinking. Maybe we realize it or not, because we are limited by the number of words we can use. And we are limited in the usage of those words by our feelings. And we are limited by millions of inputs in our lives. And when we try to communicate, we are again limited by our emotions and our limitation of word knowledge. And the other person who distills that knowledge, he does it under his own mechanism and under his own understanding of life. So Farabi also wrote on the book of letters. Then he wrote on vacuum. I'm very impressed by how he described then that there's a higher world, immaterial world of the cosmology of the universe, and there's a lower world where we are. We are with our bodies, we are limited, we decay, but there's a link between both these worlds, and that is the world of rational intelligence. Why we try, when we try and understand what we are with what is there forever, I think that is a very important contribution of Farabi. He wrote also on happiness. He was a very prolific writer. He wrote a number of treatises. And probably one of the most important characters who brought the knowledge of the old era, which was also much older than him, and he brought it to the medieval, what is called by Europe as the Dark Ages, but was the ages of the enlightenment of the Muslim world. Muslim world communicated honestly. The inheritance from the Greek, in fact, even in Pakistan and India, you never think of indigenous medicine. Of course, indigenous medicine, but it was labeled as Yunani Tib. It was a Greek inheritance, and we gave credit. So we never owned it or we did improve upon it, but we gave credit to the Greek Yunani Tib in that. So let me tell you what impresses me most in Al-Farabi. His book, Al-Madinatul Fazila, and that's a very important book in the sense it talks about a state. The Republic, Plato's dialogue talks about the state. Farabi talks about the state also. And he talks about the city, Al-Madina. Al-Madina is a city. And then he said, a good city. What is a good city like? And then he talks about Riyasat-e-Madina, which is the contemporary dialogue of the present government in Pakistan also. Mr. Imran Khan talks about the rights of Riyasat-e-Madina, the functioning of Riyasat-e-Madina, the principles of Riyasat-e-Madina, the social understanding of the state with respect to the people of people in any city or in any state. So Farabi wrote about Al-Madinatul Fazila, and every philosopher, starting from Plato, even from Socrates, talked about, first they talked about what was there, how much they understood, and then they talked about organization and about a state and the functions of the leaders of the state. And there were evil writers also, like Machiavelli wrote on The Prince, and some of you who read, not a big book, a small one, if you read it, it says how in a very cunning manner you can run, you can work with the emotions of people and exploit them. So Riyasat-e-Madina today is a concept in the Muslim world, that the best possible state was the state of Medina when Huzur Ikram sallallahu alaihi wasallam laid down the principles in communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, laid down the principles which are eternal as far as relationship between human beings are concerned. The ethics are eternal. The principles are eternal. Circumstances will change. People will move instead of camels in cars. Instead of miswak, people would use a toothbrush. But the principles remain the same because humanity in its emotions will never change. Humanity lives with its emotions which are love, hate and phobias, like I mentioned somewhere also a few days ago. So ladies and gentlemen, the most important thing which Farabi did, and the most important thing for the Ummah today, and for the OIC, and for you gentlemen today, is the fact that we believe in our own countries, and we believe as the Muslim Ummah, that we have been left behind by the current scientific knowledge of the world. And it is running faster. If you thought that knowledge is going at a pace where you can catch up with it, let me give you some news. It is running much faster than what you ever thought. There's a change which is happening. There's a change like the Industrial Revolution, for example. There's changes in artificial intelligence and thinking which is around the corner, and it is very fast. I was reading a book, Superintelligence by Nick Bostrom, and the fact that we do not know what will happen in the next 10 years means that we'll be left further behind. There's an acceleration which is around us. So it is very alarming for me to present to you, before you. And this forum is one forum which is talking about the most important situation. Like, for example, about 100 years ago, about 150 years ago, when Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, in India and Pakistan, in this region, when he talked about that the Muslims have to learn, it was a process which we thought it will take a couple of generations, and if you start learning, you will catch up. That is not true today. You don't have the time of a couple of generations anymore. By the time we will learn what is happening, science, technology, artificial intelligence, the internet would have gone far beyond. So therefore, this is a warning bell. And in fact, Comstec is a great institution, in fact, which should have the burden, which should carry the burden of trying to motivate the Islamic world that unless you have knowledge, you will not be able to improve your lot. It's not the question of defense. It's not the question of armaments. If you purchase armaments from somebody, they are stale the time you purchase it. Sometimes we may have pride that we have purchased these armaments and we are strong. The strength comes from intellect. The strength comes from thinking. The strength comes from building character. The strength comes from principles. The strength comes from ethics, which Islam has given to you as a permanence. You have that strength. But that strength has to be translated into scientific current knowledge to have an advantage, not on other countries. Islam never thinks of exploitation. Islam thinks of serving your own lot. Well, Islam thinks of insaf. Islam thinks of establishing a state where the rights of people, that is the biggest message of Islam, the message that Allah is one, and the message that the Prophet is the last Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just lays down the principles on which then you learn. So the source is described, and the source is described for you to believe that whatever information is coming to you, therefore, is the true information. So you don't have to follow the scientific principles of Islam. The principles of Islam are more ethical and moral. And today in the world, if you look around at the United Nations, the international forums, there is lack of morality. And I was reading, I've been talking about the morality in international institutions, and I was reading Sir Agha Muhammad Khan III's memoirs, and he talked about the fact that he was the president of the League of Nations in 1939, I don't remember, 1939 or 1938, and he wrote that the institutions in the world lack morality. And even today, the weightage of money, the weightage of trade, the weightage of armaments, the weightage of brute force is there in institutions which are supposed and which should have been. And that is where the Republic or Al-Madinatul Fadila or the fact that the Constitution of Islam or the Quran by itself, the biggest one, lays down those principles which are lacking today in the world. So if the world is not looking for morality, we Muslims are looking for morality. We believe in morality. But lo and behold, when we have problems like Kashmir and Palestine, we realize the world doesn't care about us. Why? Because either we are talking of Pidram Sultan Booth, that we were strong, our Iman is strong, there's nothing which can defeat us. But Iman needs a combination of scientific knowledge to be able to improve your lot. We are not defeating nations. We improve it. Your people are in misery. Look at India. The Muslims are in misery. Look at Palestine. Look at Kashmir. They're in misery. Look at the Rohingyas. They're in misery. Even we ourselves, we have poverty. We are not able to take care of our own. But that can't happen. If you have pukhta iman, God will not change you because God has implemented principles. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his own principles of running this world. He gives leadership. He gives chance to people who can change, who are leaders in the world in his knowledge. So it is important that we go pick up the principles of Al-Farabi, the guidance of Al-Farabi, for example. And the guidance is simple. His knowledge probably is outdated, but his principles, his arguments are probably very current. And based upon those principles and arguments, ladies and gentlemen, it is up to us. The future looks to us. The Muslim Ummah looks to you. The Muslim Ummah believes that there can be a change. And we have talked about change for a long time. Every leader in the Muslim world has been talking about change. But to be able to do it, we have to work harder. We have to ensure the fact that our people get educated. We have to ensure the fact that people are healthy. These two are the combinations to lift us out of poverty. And as we get educated and with higher education, we have a chance. So ladies and gentlemen, not let that chance go. Thank you. Thank you very much.